Today we'll start discussing what is generally called the control structures in C++. They encompass conditional execution of statements, something which we are going to see in some details today. The control structures in C++ also provide for building iterations or building constructs such that some instructions of your program can be repeatedly executed. Why would you like to do that is something that we have to see through some problems. But essentially it is the control structures which give the enormous power to us to write appropriate computer programs such that not only we can implement our computational logic properly, which may require conditional execution of statements, but we can also specify iterative instructions, which can mean thousands of instructions are executed while you write only 4 or 5 instructions or 10 instructions. So that's the beauty of iterative solution. Today we are going to discuss the problems that require conditional execution of statement, and to illustrate our point of flow of control, we'll introduce a new graphical representation of our algorithms called flowcharts. Subsequently, we'll discuss the if, if-else, and switch statements. I will briefly describe the labs next week and the lectures next week, and some general announcements at the end. So, what are flowcharts? First of all, they use a graphical notation to indicate how, in what sequence, the instructions in our program are executed. It might appear rather silly, because when we consider programs such as the one which is written here on the screen, the flow of control is obvious. First you instruction the first instruction, then you execute the second instruction, then the third, then the fourth. But graphically, we might want to depict this in some kind of action boxes. The rectangular boxes that you see are called action boxes. Inside each action box, some activity is written which is expected to be executed by the corresponding instruction. In a flow chart, typically you write the actions in plain English. It is not necessary to write C++ statements. I am just illustrating the point. You will notice that the arrows very clearly indicate what will be done first, what will be done next. So an arrow head says that the instruction C in greater greater B will not be executed before C in greater greater A is executed. Similarly, sum is equal to A plus B will be executed only after C in greater greater B is executed. If you look at the logic of this program, even if I interchange the first two boxes, will it affect the result? No. But if I put the third box at the top, then clearly I will have something very funny happening. Because sum equal to A plus B, if executed without inputting values of A and B, it will just collect some garbage that lies in the location for A and B, calculate the sum and give it to us. So that is why even this simple sequence is important, because sequences cannot always be interchanged in terms of the actions. So this is the notation for a flowchart. There are a couple of other notations. For example, start of the algorithm is often depicted by writing start in a elliptical box, and similarly end of the algorithm is depicted by writing stop at the end. But that is notional. Most of the time, if at all we draw algorithms, we will be drawing those flowcharts for representing a segment of our logic. Notice that we need not write C++ statements. So this flowchart indicates that I can just say input A, input B. Sum is equal to A plus B is a universal assignment operation that we understand now, and we output the sum. Here is a simple computational problem. Starting from a point, a person starts walking at a fixed velocity. The steady speed is given as 2 kilometers per hour. He walks for an hour. So write a program to determine the distance traveled by the person in some given time t. I can formulate a mathematical equation to represent the relationship between the distance traveled and the time. That would be a straightforward straight line relation. And the straight line relation would depend, of course, upon the time. But let's say this is 1 hour, and this is 1, 2 kilometers. So the straight line will be. You agree? Now, obviously, if I want to determine what is the distance traveled by the person at any point in time, I will have to find out what is the value of d for a given t as per this formula. D is equal to 2 star t. In fact, it's an absolutely straightforward problem. I would like to mention at this juncture that you may want to consider this to be a particular case of a more generalized mathematical model, which is y is equal to mx plus c. You are familiar with this? Represents the equation of a straight line. Now, if this was my algorithm, this was my problem, how would I write the program? Well, this is a sample program. Forget the first 3-4 lines, don't waste your time looking at that. But it asks you to give a value of time. Notice that I have written backslash n in the cout statement, indicating a new line character. That is one way of writing it. The other way is to introduce a very special name called NL as a separate item to be output. More importantly, I get the value of time as input. I calculate distance equal to 2.0 into time, and I output distance traveled is distance. Any problems with this algorithm? No issues. Come again. Slash n. His question is, what is the function of the slash n? You will recall that when we discussed the char type, we said a char type is capable of storing the ASCII code of a symbol. Now, there are symbols which are obvious and visible to us, like A, B, P, plus, minus, and those we can write in our programs as they are. But there are symbols which are not visible to us, like a space. Now, how do you write? Space is actually visible when we edit a program because a blank space appears. But a tab, which is like 8 spaces or 6 spaces, it will not appear explicitly as a tab. Similarly, on the screen, when you see, you start writing a program like this, and when you press a carriage return or enter, you go to the next line. Now, there is a character there which is called the new line character. That is not visible to you. But when you press enter in your program editing, that new line you automatically get. Now we are talking about producing an output where things should appear on different lines. How do you ensure that? How do you tell the C++ to produce an output after that printing this line? Let's say you, after printing this message, you want the machine to say next thing should go to the next line. How do you say that? So you have to insert a new line character forcibly into the output stream. That backslash n is nothing but that new line character. So is this clear? Yeah. The errors would be for completely different reasons. New line is your, please understand, new line is an option. If I don't give the new line, it will not produce a new line in the output. So subsequent output will come on the same line. This is not an erroneous statement. So if you got an error, go back to your lab and find out what other errors are. Okay? If I were to write a flowchart for this, how would it look like? It would actually be very simple. I will say input T, then I will say D is equal to 2T, and I will say notice that I am not using the names which I have used in the C++ flow. I am also not using the rigorous C++ syntax of writing an expression. But I am writing in commonly known mathematical terms. And I am using symbolisms which should be obvious to anyone who has read that problem. Is that correct? So, the relationship between a flowchart and a program is more logical. It's not one-to-one. You don't have to write exactly. Okay, the point being made here is, this is a straightforward problem. You write a sequence of instructions, they are executed in the given sequence, presto, you get the final answer. I now complicate the problem slightly. Read this problem. The first part of the problem is same. It says person walks at a steady speed of 2 kilometers per hour for 1 hour, and the person then starts running at a speed of 4 kilometers per hour. And that he does it for 2 hours and then stops. Write a program to determine the distance traveled by the person in some given time t. Problem is same. But now if I were to mathematically formulate the relationship between distance and time, I actually get two straight lines. The first straight line, let me write down slightly elongated scale on the time side. So this is 1 hour, 2 hours, and 3 hours. Let me write down a slightly compressed scale on the y side, because physically the screen is limited on the vertical axis. So let me say this is 1 kilometer, 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers, 4 kilometers, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, approximately. So this is 8, this is 4, and so on. So what will be the graph that will be depicting the relationship between distance and time? For the first hour, the person walks at a speed of 2 kilometers per hour. So that means in the first hour, the fellow is likely to reach somewhere here. So the straight line depicting his movement will be like this. But after that hour, the person starts running at the speed of 4 kilometers per hour. In 2 hours, how many kilometers the fellow will run? 8. He has already traveled 2 kilometers. So the next straight line will be from 2 kilometers at this point to 10 kilometers at the end of 3 hours. So I will require one more point here somewhere, and let us say this is that point. Oops, sorry. I can't delete this, so I will leave it as it is. But effectively now it is not showing two different straight lines. Let me see if I can delete. No, unless I, okay, fine. I'll just leave it at that. But you agree that there are two different straight lines. Let me draw these straight lines something like this so that they are sharply known. The point is, given a value of time anybody can give. Time can be 1.3 hours, 2.4 hours, 0.6 hours. By the way, we should also discuss how exactly one would give time. Usually people, when they tell us a time value, they tell it in time, hours, minutes and seconds. Have you anybody seen saying time is 2.63 hours after that point? No. So that is another point that we will have to worry about. But currently we are talking about maths. But maths also, given a time, there is no single formula which will calculate the distance. In this part of the curve, what is the equivalent of distance is equal to? 2 times time. But in this part of the curve, what is the formula? Is that correct? No. D is equal to 4T, is it correct? Plus 2. He is suggesting D is equal to 4T. Okay. Let's calculate. Let's say T is equal to 2 hours. As per this formula, I will get the answer as 8 kilometers. This is clearly wrong. Okay, the formula suggested is D is equal to 4T minus 2. Let's apply that. At 2 hours, this should be equal to 8 minus 2, which is equal to 6. Is that correct? At 3 hours, what will be the result? 12 minus 2, which is equal to 10. Looks correct? Some verification that we should do. Main point is not that. The main point is, how do I write my program? If I write D equal to 2T, I will get correct answer if T is less than 1 hour. If I write D is equal to 4T minus 2, I will get correct answer only if T is more than that time, but not otherwise. We cannot write a correct C++ program with the given power of calculation that we know. We need something more. And that something is provided by a construct which we shall see in the context of another problem, which is very similar. Cost of a ticket for a bus journey from some point A to some town B, whatever, is, let us say, 25 rupees 50 paise. But the bus company gives a concession for children. If the age is less than 12 years, the cost of the ticket is only 12 rupees 75 paise. Given the age of the passenger, write a program to calculate the cost of a ticket. Do you realize that this is very similar in concept to the problem that we faced earlier? That if age is up to 12 years, the price of the ticket is something. If the age is beyond 12 years, the price of the ticket is something else. Okay. No computation is involved. We have to finally look at the statements that are written here on the slide. Int, age, float, ticket, cost. Is age integer? I have declared int age. I have declared float ticket underscore cost. Obviously, ticket underscore cost is fraction. I have rupees and paise. But is age integer? Yes and no. What is the right answer? The actual answer is age of a person is not integer unless you measure it in microseconds. If you measure the age in years, which is what we normally do, the age of a child could be 10 and a half years. My age is, for example, 63 and a half years. I won't say 63. However, those who say yes to int are also right, because in the context of the problem that we are solving, it is immaterial what exactly the age of a person is in terms of fraction. The problem simply states 12 years or more, 12 years or less than. In which case, anybody who says 10, 11, 9 is a child. Anybody who says 13, 14, 15 is an elder. Anybody who says 12 has a problem. Generally, the parents will always say 11 when the person has birth date today or yesterday. But if the birth date has happened yesterday, today the age will be 12. Anyway, that is more for the legality and morality. But we agree that as far as this problem is concerned, integer age is perfectly fine. Anyway, so I define these and I input the age. So I got a value of age, 53, 12, 10, whatever. Now I have a problem. How do I write instructions to calculate the correct cost? In this case, we wish to tell C++ a very peculiar thing. Because remember, we in that program somewhere, we will have to say cost of ticket or ticket cost is 12.75, and somewhere we will have to say cost is 25.5, because both of them will be valid in some time or the other. But what we want to specify is that depending on the age, you execute that statement or that statement. So what we want to say is if age is less than 25 years, then calculate the cost of ticket as 12.75, else calculate the cost of ticket as 25. So what we wish to do is we wish to write a program which will either execute the first statement or execute the second statement, but never both. Currently, we do not know the mechanism. Whatever we write is executed as it is. And that's why we say that this is an extremely powerful construct, which is provided in C++ through an if statement. So what we want to do logically is, we want first to examine the value of age. If age is less than 12, we want to do something. If age is not less than 12, we want to do something else. In the flow chart, this is depicted by a diamond box. Remember, we saw all rectangular boxes. Rectangular boxes in a flowchart always show an action. But a diamond box shows a question to be asked, a condition to be evaluated. For example, I may say here, age less than 25. So this is not a statement, this is a question. Is age less than 25? The answer is either yes, which is logically called true, or the answer is no, which is logically called false. Some of you would be familiar with true and false nomenclature in the context of Boolean algebra if you have studied it. It's same as true. The point is, now I have two different paths. Only one of the two will be taken, not both, never both. Obviously, if I have instructions to be executed, if age is indeed less than 25, I would write them beneath this arrow. If I have instructions to be executed, if the age is not less than 25, I should write them beneath this arrow. Eventually, whatever instructions I execute in either this path or that path, the arrows may come back to indicate subsequent flow of instructions in the normal sense. The flow chart depicting the solution for this problem is shown here. For the benefit of people who want to write a C++ program directly, I have written C++ instruction syntax inside the boxes. Although, as you know, it is not required. So, I take input as age. I ask the question, is age less than 12? It is this question which is not written exactly as per the syntax of C++. We shall see what the syntax is. Okay. But the answer is true or false. If the answer is true, TC, which I have used as a short form to represent ticket cost, is set to 12.75, and then I go down to output. On the other hand, if age is not less than 12, I go to another path completely, execute another instruction, TC equal to 25.50, and come back again to do this. Now, this going somewhere and coming back, going somewhere else and coming back, has to be indicated in a text form, because our program is lines of text. So how do you, when C++ compiler is reading our instructions, how from a text file or lines of text can it understand that these lines represent actions in the yes path, those lines represent actions in the no path, and after that this whole jhamela is complete, subsequent things are to be executed in any case. How do we say that? That is where the powerful syntax rules of C++ permit us to do that. The instruction which implements such conditional execution is called the if instruction. The if statement is written in the form that is shown there. If in parenthesis condition, parenthesis closed, statement 1, semicolon, else statement 2. So the composite if statement consists of these two lines or these two instructions, if you may so call, if and else, it's a pair. If some condition is true, execute statement 1, otherwise execute statement 2. What are conditions? Conditions are like the question that we ask. Usually there will be comparison conditions because we are dealing with values. So I have given some examples of the conditions that can be written. Count less than equal to n, that's a condition. Depending upon whatever is the value of count and whatever is the value of n at that instance, this condition will be either true or false. By the way, when we write the program, we don't know in advance whether the condition is true or false. If we did, we won't write an if statement. Values may change when the program is executed. Today the program is executed with one set of values, some conditions may be true, some may be false. Tomorrow the program is executed with some other values, the same conditions may work out to be false, some other conditions may work out to be false. I have written a slightly complex example. New underscore value minus old underscore value less than 1.0 e minus 5. Please note that condition is a comparison of values. There is a comparison operator such as less than equal to. We shall see what those operators are. And on either side of those operators are values. And each value can be written as a full-fledged expression. So this is not to be confused with an assignment statement. I am comparing two expression values in general. More specifically, I may be comparing simple things like count less than equal to. But comparisons such as these are perfectly valid. Look at the third line of the examples. Age greater than equal to 12. The other condition written is age less than 12. Do they mean the same thing? Do they mean something different? Yes. They actually indicate the same concern that we have about computation, but they are written as a negation of the other. So, consequently, if I were to write that diamond box, or if the if statement of this, if age greater than 12 is the condition I write, then against the statement 1, I have to write what I have to do if age is greater than. And against else, I have to write the other part. On the other hand, if I say if age less than 12, then statement 1 will indicate what is to be done if age is less than 12, and else will indicate what is to be done. Is that clear? It's pretty simple stuff actually, but it's critical to understand the exact syntax and the mean. So the last few lines in the slide give exactly how C++ will approach it. First, it will evaluate the condition. It will, please note now the rules are as rigorous as the assignment statements. We have spent a lot of time in understanding why I can't write A square equal to 5. Because A square is not a valid left hand side. Similarly, we have understood that if we say M is equal to M plus 5, there is no confusion or dichotomy. It doesn't look at the left hand side. Firstly, it looks at the right hand side, evaluates expression, gets a value, puts it in the left. In exactly the same way, we should understand the rules of the game for the if statement. If something statement 1 semicolon L statement 2 semicolon is a group. In this entire group, C++ first looks at the condition, then bother with anything else. It evaluates the condition. It evaluates the condition to a logical value, which is true or false. If the value is true, it will execute statement 1. If the value is false, it will execute statement 2. Is that clear? The general flowchart for an if statement will be, the most important point to remember apart from the logic of if is that in either case, after executing statement 1 or after executing statement 2, the control will go within the C++ program to the statement written immediately after the L statement. That statement will be executed always, no matter what was the condition. Is that clear? So here is an implementation of C++ of our problem. If in bracket age less than 12, bracket closed, ticket cost is equal to 12.75 semicolon, else ticket cost is equal to 25.50 semicolon. You get this? Very simple. Please understand that this entire segment is to be considered as some kind of a block. It's a single statement in a sense. It's compound, but it's a single statement. If something else. It is also possible that we may have a situation where we want to conditionally execute some statement if the condition is true, but otherwise we don't have anything special to do. We want to carry on further. Such a block would be represented by, I'll say, condition C. So you see, on the else path, there is nothing to be done. In such a situation, I can simply write if C and carry on with it. There is no else path. Is that clear? Why would I do such a thing? Can I use this structure to solve the bus ticket problem? You can. I will just write down some simple instructions. Just check whether they make sense. Do you agree that these two lines will actually solve my problem correctly? What I am doing is clever. First I am saying, look, I don't even care for your age. I will assign the value of ticket cost as 25.50. Now I will say, what is your age? Oh, less than 12? Sorry. I get back my 25.0, TC is equal to 12.7. This is a neater code in some sense, and there are some problems where we will find that it is precisely the use of such tricks which will help us enormously shorten our programs. However, please note that in half the cases on an average, this program will execute an assignment operation twice. In fact, every time a child comes for a ticket purchase, I will first make an assignment statement of 25 and then check. Every time an elder person comes, I will not evaluate any condition first. I will assign the correct value. Examine the condition. Condition is false, so the other assignment will not happen. Is this clear? Small squiggle, but it is valid, and this is a version of the if statement which is permanent. What if I have multiple actions to be executed on either side of true or false? For example, let me call these as S1, S2, S3, and let me call this as, let's say, yes and no. So I'll call this N1, N2. There are some statements. Y is equal to something, something, Z equal to something. I really want in my complicated logic I have in my life to solve a problem which says, if some condition is met, then do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. Otherwise, do that, In either case, go back as here is where we use the power of the notion of a block, where C++ recognizes anything which is enclosed in curly brackets as a single statement. It is therefore possible for us to write, if C, a curly bracket, S1, S2, S3, curly bracket closed, else another curly bracket, N1, N2 with semicolons, and then a curly bracket here. What C++ says is, you are saying if C, then a curly bracket. That means now, till the end of this corresponding curly bracket, there may be 5, 10, 500 statements. All of them are to be considered to lie on the true path of the condition. And I'll execute all of them if ever I come here. However, if the condition is false, I will never come to this curly bracket. I will go to else statement. Else again has a curly bracket, and therefore, I will execute all those things N1, N2 or whatever you have on the no path, and till I complete the end of that curly bracket. However, in either case, I will go to the next statement which follows this block. Is this clear? So this is the power of the logic of treating multiple statements as a single statement. And since in most problems, we would not know whether an if statement will have after the condition only one statement to be executed or more, on the else side only one statement to be executed or more. Even when we write the program, it may require only one statement, but in future when I modify the program, I may have to include additional actions on the true path or false path, and therefore a good practice, not mandatory but good practice, is to write a program like this. So forget the top few lines. I get the age of the passenger, check. If age less than 12, opening curly bracket, ticket cost is equal to 12.75, semicolon. Else, opening curly bracket, integer ticket underscore cost is equal to 25.50, curly bracket. You see now the advantage? I can put as many instructions as I want after this in my curly bracket, they will all be regarded as a single instruction. In general, a single instruction written in a line separately does not make sense to have two curly brackets around it. So that is why we often will write this as, this is the condition, I will write a curly bracket here, I will write statements here, and then I will write a curly bracket here. This is a better practice. After conditions, you write a curly bracket. In fact, you go to the next line and first type the closing curly bracket. Now you go one line up and start inserting your instruction. Notice the indentation. Remember, I said you leave a few blanks at the beginning of a line to indicate what component of the program that code line belongs. And here you can see the advantage. Whatever is to be done on the true side is indented two spaces on the right. Whatever is to be done on the false side is indented two spaces on the right. So that way, you can very easily identify the true block and the false block. Is that clear? Yeah.
We have to put semicolon after the end of the statement in the curly bracket, or we have to put it after the curly bracket.
Very good. In fact, the statement should be put inside the curly bracket. This is a mistake. You see, the curly bracket merely encloses statements. Okay, curly bracket itself is not a statement. So, he is very correct. Thanks for pointing this out. This should be semicolon, curly bracket, semicolon, curly bracket. So, you got the idea now? If I have multiple statements, I could enclose them in curly brackets and they would be treated as a single statement. Here is another variation, where luckily I have corrected that error. This variation checks if age is greater than or equal to 12. Remember, I said the two conditions are equivalent, but one is negation of the other. So now you will see that what was appearing in the true part of the previous if statement is now appearing in the false part of this, under the else. Okay. So if age is greater than 12, ticket cost is so much, else ticket cost is so much. So it's simple, isn't it? Conditional execution. You can extend it to include any kind of complications. What kind of complications may result? Now the bus company introduces senior citizen concession. People like me who are older than 60 years can pay only 20 rupees. Not as less as a child, but not as much as a working adult. How do you take care of this situation? Now there are actually three different conditions. One condition, if you are older than 60 years. Another condition, if you are older than 12 years but less than 60 years. Third condition, if you are less than 12 years, right? One possible program is written here. If age is greater than 60, ticket cost is 20. Else, if age is greater than or equal to 12, ticket cost is equal to this. Else, ticket cost is this. Since the conditions here are such that one flows from the other, next flows from this. And therefore, this structure is called an if-else ladder. You know the ladder? CD. You climb up. So there are steps in the CD. So these are like steps. First step this, then step, then this, then. So this is a very simple structure. You can have more complication. If you remember that after if and after condition, you are permitted to write a statement. It doesn't say which statement. That statement itself can be an if statement, as you can see it is here. Within that if statement on the yes side and else side, again there can be other if statements. So you can complicate the life as completely as you want. One of the problems in the handout that I will give you asks you to implement that complicated one. So you will have, this is called nested ifs, if within an if, and then you may sometimes have a problem that the else statement that you will write somewhere deep, you may forget this else correspond to this if or that if or that if. Okay. So that is where the indentation will help you. Please note, indentation is only to improve your readability. C++ doesn't give a damn whether you indent or not, but it will correctly keep track of how many ifs you have got, how many elses you have got, and which one matches where. Yeah. No. Please note, if age is greater than 60, ticket cost is 20 will be executed. But the next statement is not written as if it should be always executed. There is an else there. Else means that only if age is not greater than 60, then whatever is stated here will be executed. It will, the control will never come to that statement if age is greater than 60. That is the whole point. Okay, just let us, this is a good question that he raises. So therefore, you should always look at the flowchart of this. The flowchart of this structure says, is age greater than 60? If the answer is yes, you will come here and do what? TC is equal to 20. Only if the answer is no, you will come here. On the no side, when will you come? The else statement. The else statement is executed only if the answer is no to the first question, not otherwise. Even after coming to the else side, you are not doing anything concrete. You are again examining another condition. So there is another thing, which says, is age greater than equal to 12? Here the answer could be yes or no. If the answer is yes, what are you saying? TC is equal to 25.5. If it is no, you are saying TC is equal to 12.75. And in here, you are coming in either case like this. And here, you are coming in either case like this. This is the logic which is implemented by this ladder. Yeah.
So,
you can, okay, his question is, can I not write this differently by saying, if age is greater than equal to 12 and age is less than something, that's a composite condition. We shall see those composite conditions shortly. But to answer his point where he's asking, his question was, can I not write it differently? Of course you can write it differently. And of course, there is no unique way of implementing a conditional logic in your problem. No unique way. When you see more complicated problem, in fact, one of the problems in the problem set, I will not be surprised if there are 20 different ways in which you write the conditions in C++. Each one of those ways may be correct. That is perfectly fine. But let's come back to the question that our friend had asked. Are you convinced now what is happening? Sorry, I forgot who asked this question. You see, I am not coming to examine whether age is greater than or equal to 12 or not. I am not coming to that point at all if age is greater than 60. If age is greater than 60, I am supposed to calculate TC equal to this and get out. I will come to this part only if that condition, that is the power of else. If I forget to write else, what you say will be.